Reserve time. Radiant team ban.
Hello and welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to a joinDOTA community presentation of the International Qualifiers North America Day 2. Here is Team Liquid versus Top5 here towards the tail end of our day. Thank you guys so much for joining us on this wonderful day of NA Dota. I myself am Blaze, and today I am joined by Gorgon. What's going on, man?
Oh, not so much. You sound so official with your intro.
I was like trying to get in the zone, man. This is the icebreaker here. This is my first TI4 QualiCast, and gotta make it count.
Well, welcome to the team at the TI4 QualiCasters. And yeah, I felt like I was in a planetarium or something. It was really nice. It was relaxing.
Team Liquid.
My intros are always way too excited while people in Twitch chat are always like, why is he yelling? The game hasn't started yet. I like Dota. I get excited. It's not my fault.
And, I mean, what not to get excited about? We got a freaking Mirana pick. We haven't seen that all day, so.
Yeah, Mirana was doing, I mean, she blew up yesterday, and she's been banned out almost every game because nobody wants to let her be played. Her overall stats are staggering for the TI. I mean, remaining. She was played yesterday, I think over 30 times, with a 70-something percent win rate. I'm trying to pull it up. 73% win rate, played 23 times.
Reserve time.
And we haven't seen her a whole ton today because she's been banned out all day long. Team Liquid, going to grab Darkseer, Shadow Demon. So denying that Shadow Demon to the Mirana, that's a pretty smart move.
Yeah, I mean, that's an important thing. There are, of course, plenty of other combos that can work. Either Rubick TK can set things up. We've seen some play with, like, Wraith King and Treants and things like that. But the other hero that it kind of hasn't been mentioned recently as far as his potential synergy in the lane is the Bane. Obviously, there are weaknesses to waking somebody up via Nightmare and so on and so forth, but it's still a hero that brings a lot of utility to the lineup and can make things work. It's just not one that you're going to see in the first phase. There's not really too much incentive to pick it up. It's not going to get banned out for the most part.
Yeah, Bane just doesn't really fit the current meta that well. The meta that's really based on high activity and pushing. He doesn't really provide that much to that style of game plan. He was really popular for a long time, and the entire time he was popular, I was just crying to myself, why is Shadow Demon not the priority pick? And why is Bane? Shadow Demon fits the way the meta is going so well, and now we have seen that switch over. I think it makes a lot more sense. The Bane obviously does work very well, but with the Soul Catcher on top of the Disruption coming out with that Shadow Demon, he's just much more effective in the laning phase. He has so much more damage output. And that's when you really need the Mirana to start getting ahead, is right from the beginning. Because she dual cores extremely well. She goes late pretty hard, but she doesn't go late as hard as a traditional hard carry. And if she isn't in a dual core especially, she needs to get out of the gate very strong.
Yeah. Team Liquid answer back with an interesting draft. Obviously, they let the Invoker slip through into top five as clutches, but we're going to see the Darkseer Shadow Demon as the phase one picks, and it's kind of an illusion-based draft where Mirana is a hero with high agi gain, 2.75, I believe, and if you can take advantage of the fact that she goes for items like Crit, items like Butterfly, to try to bring herself to that mid to late game status, the Wall of Replica and the Offensive Disruption can take huge advantage of that. So they've got kind of a good balance of mid to late game just based on stealing the stats of their opposition. And along with that, of course, they've got a couple of great defensive maneuvers. A Surge and Mech from the Darkseer, and of course the Defensive Disruption from Shadow Demon. So it comes down to control, comes down to reactive play, and Team Liquid seem in a pretty good position to deal with this Mirana Invoker threat.
Now remember that top five almost exclusively plays for late game. They don't really do any early game play whatsoever. I believe they've only won one game before. No, it's three games. They've had end before 30 minutes over the last more than a month. Jeez. And that includes their losses. Their average win is 50 minutes long. Before the TI.
That is pretty absurd, actually. Do they pick a lot of turtle presence heroes or ones that can extend the game, kind of?
Yeah, they just like to do 4 protect 1. Okay. So the Morphling is a hero that I would normally expect top 5 to go in for. They don't do a lot of this like lycanthrope stuff that is really popular right now. They don't do a lot of the team push stuff. They do like to go in and just absolutely, like, not even a augmented a modern style 4 protect, one that you see coming out like Sneaky Nyx Assassins and NAR sometimes, where they do a lot of the like, oh, we're going to be everywhere on the map, and so you're just traveling all the time, so you don't have time to focus on our Naga Siren sort of stuff. They do the traditional 4 protect one where they pick huge team fight out of 4 heroes and then one hard farmer. They do it almost every time. They've been a little bit more diverse in the TI, but for the most part, that's what we are looking for to come out of Top 5.
So, as far as standings, how does this break down as far as the relevancy of the win for either? I know Team Liquid's doing extremely well, though the most recent standings that I got, they were pretty much tied for first place. So, I'm not sure if they're worried about going down to third and having to fight out for the lower bracket, and they're obviously wanting the win for that, or how's Top 5 looking as well?
I don't actually have the standings right in front of me. Team Liquid is pretty solid in that top four, so they're not too worried. I think they're even, from what I recall, they've lost maybe two matches, one, two, so they're probably top two without too many issues. Top five, they were a little wishy-washy for a little while. They did end up losing a game over to Isurus, I believe. And that put them within striking range of Union Gaming. But Union Gaming just lost a round over to Sneaky Nyx Assassin. So I think top five, they want to win, but they are the odds off underdogs here, obviously. And if they were able to pull this off, it would say a lot about their potential for, even if they get in the top four, even if they're guaranteed top four, it would say a lot about their ability to go into the playoffs strong. So Liquid going to grab that, that Keeper Light again that they've been playing basically throughout the entire tournament.
Yeah. That's going to be actually pretty interesting to see here. I'm curious if they couple it with anything else that's pretty unique. Maybe the potential mana-dependent heroes, Storm Spirit is the one that instantly comes to mind just because he can do so much with a high mana pool, but there are tons of heroes that really fit that. And one big thing that Team Liquid really stress when they pick up the Keeper of Light is mobility. It's a walking recall once you get that Aghanim Scepter up, and he's just going to be trying to continuously bolster their forces across the map. He's going to be the mobile pretty much carrier that is going to be bringing in all the reinforcements. Remaining. So that's going to be a pretty big deal.
Yeah, he's basically a pit lord. If you get up the boots of travel on him, and then you go into any lane anytime that's unfarmed, and you just farm it out, get that Aghanim stuff, you can get them both up in like 14 minutes or less. And then you are the pit lord. You can summon everybody. You have unlimited recall ability, and you just bring everybody anywhere you go. You've got a permanent posse.
Yeah, it's going to be pretty interesting to see if he can get that eggs up at an appropriate time. He doesn't want to be fighting Morphling for farm whatsoever, but he might be able to steal some from the Darkseer after he gets that mechanism up and just kind of farm things away. Of course, there are plenty of other awesome utilities, too, that Aghanims, you get the clear vision during the daytime,
so nice.
Which is just pretty amazing. And then, of course, you also are able to have all your permanent spirit form, so that's going to be pretty cool. The last bit is the healing factor of the Illuminate. Decent for pushing, decent for keeping Morphling up when he's really backed in, stunned out, and trying to just strength morph for his life, but if the AA has anything to say about it, that won't take much of an effect here.
Yeah, Liquid is hurting for lockdown, though. They don't really have a lot of strong ways to hold top five in place. So top five, if they do go maneuverable, which with the Mirana and Sand King, it looks like they're going to do, they could run into some trouble in these mid-game team fights as top five coalesces as four. Once again, I'm expecting this. Well, this will probably be something like an aggressive tri lane with the Ancient Apparition Sand King Mirana. Maybe an Invoker mid or safe lane with a solo safe laner as well. And we'll have to see what they want to do. The Kunk are going to come out to give that mid-game presence for Team Liquid. So they're going to transition. Shadow Demon and the Keeper Light doing well for the early game. Probably some rotations. Moving into the Kunkka. Moving into the Morphling. So they're just going to scale from one hero to the other, getting their strength out. Top five right now, they hit really hard in the mid game. So I expect, once again, more late game style hero to be coming out. But right now, I'd say 15 to 20 minutes, top five really comes into their own with almost all of their heroes. The Sand King will have the Blink Dagger up. The Mirana will have up her basic damage items. Invoker, who is probably an Exord Invoker, is going to be starting to swing some pretty heavy fireballs off his own, and AA is going to have that ult. The Chilling Blast is going to be maxed out, and Chilling Touch and the Ice Blast both going to be rolling. It's going to be very difficult for Team Liquid to deal with that mid game resting solely on the back of that Kunkka, unless they have a strong early game out that Keeper Light and Shadow Demon.
Yeah. So I'm actually curious how Team Liquid is going to lane this. I would love to see something like a Shadow Demon Kunkka, a mid lane, to deal with the Invoker threat a little bit in the early game. I mean, get a disruption to Torrent, and that you don't even need to skill up the X to have a large amount of presence there. And Morphling Keeper seems to fit pretty well together since they're just going to be dealing with an offlane Tidehunter. It's very difficult to actually kill the guy. Like you said, they don't have that much great disable. So unless we're seeing some Warcraft 3 body blocks, we're going to see DJ most likely survive through the laning phase for the most part here. But that assumes he's going to be running in the offlane. Of course, top 5 have a lot of potential for aggro try, but I think Team Liquid have a pretty good response. Shadow Demon, Caudle, they fit hand in hand as well, and if they are under pressure by those three heroes, I think more often than not, Shanks is going to run in, he wants to Burrow Strike, he wants to deliver some Chilling Touch right clicks, and then he'll eat a giant battle. Illuminate in the face and have to be forced into retreat. So I definitely think that it'll be interesting how it transitions to the mid game, but I think both teams are happy with kind of a passive early stage.
Yeah, it does look like that is going to be the case. Sand King probably going to go into that safe lane. I really would, like, with this draft that Top 5 has gotten themselves, any other team, I would really love to see the aggressive tri lane. But once again, Top 5 doesn't play the early game. They just don't really do it. And so it's kind of a toss-up because the early game is the point in time when you need the absolute most pinpoint precision between your heroes because there's so little margin for error with so many magic spells flying out. The stuns are very important. And of course, you have less health on your heroes in that period of time and less ability to heal them back up with things like mechanism. So if you are a squad like your top fives that doesn't really play the early game, or E-Hug is another squad that suffers from this, doing the very aggressive early game styles can actually cost you a lot because your players just aren't used to it. They don't have that pinpoint precision that some other squads might have.
Yeah, that's some on-point analysis. They still might go for some first blood movement, maybe a gank on mid before farming up their jungle and playing passively, just because Shanks did go for this boots first and enables that level 1 Burrow Strike to actually be a relevant threat. The only time you get a Burrow Strike without boots is at level 1 is if you're getting somebody completely caught off guard or you've got an Invis rune. So.
Yeah, or somebody like a VS to set you up or something like that, yeah. Like a nice stun to
extenuating circumstances, to be
yeah,
sure.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just, it's very difficult to actually make that presence known. And Ancient Apparition, you might say that something similar. He doesn't really have that much potential to unleash the Chilling Touch in full unless it's actually a full 3v3 clash. If it's a 3 versus 1, you'll probably get one or two auto attacks off, and you really need the follow-up disables, which Invoker just won't have at the first couple of levels. He's going Exhort, he won't have Cold Snap until at least level 3, and so that gank opportunity might not be the easiest. But anyways, let's go through our introductions here, starting things off here in the International Qualifiers, North America. We do see Top 5 is fighting it out for their controlling their position in the top 4. And Liquid, they want to stay in the top 2, make sure they get through to that upper bracket. So looking over at the Radiant side, we're looking at top 5. We're going to be seeing Shanks running on the Sand King support here with boots first down bottom lane. He is going to be supported alongside by Ancient Apparition, played by whatever. Really, really dry bone build for him as far as items go, but yeah, such is the way of the support. We do see Patzel is going to be running on the core Morana here, early Bastion, maybe Aquila. It is going to be Fly to pick up the Exhort Invoker on the mid lane. And here on the offlane, we're going to be looking at DJ on that Tide.
All right, and for Team Liquid, we are going to have Pegasus, that's Demon, on the Keeper of the Light. We're going to have Way Too Sexy taking that Shadow Demon.
The
We've got TC
begins.
Taking the Kunkka, and Bulba is going to be on that Purple Pirate, the Dark Seer. And Koitpa is going to be on the Morphling.
Yeah, it's going to be pretty interesting here. Bulba, like, practically invented Dark Seer, so
yeah,
obviously. He's going to be able to control this 1v1 between Tidehunter a little bit here. Nah, but he has been playing it a lot recently, and that's going to be interesting. But all eyes are really going to be on the bottom lane as far as how these 3v3 clashes go back and forth. This, like I said, Disruption into Illuminate is going to be really good, but I kind of feel like they need to get level 2 early if they're going to be able to keep that pressure going. They might be able to get First Blood, but in order to guarantee that they can keep spamming those spells out, they're going to have to get to level 2 and level 3 Chakra and make sure that Demon can continuously infuse them with that a little bit of extra sustainability.
Now, yeah, here's the trouble with this aggressive tri-lane too, and I don't want to cut too deep into this, but the rotations coming out of these supports are going to be very dangerous to leave the Morphling alone. It's hard to rotate out of this aggressive tri-lane when you have a hero like the Morphling, who is reliant on one escape to get away, and also very reliant on farm. They don't want to leave him alone. They also want to be able to rotate into that mid and grab a kill, so probably sometime in the 4 or 5 minute range when the first night falls, so they've got to make sure they're executing well in this aggressive tri-lane so that they have the time to get away for those rotations.
Yeah. Another weakness is that the Darkseer is not going to be able to rotate as quickly as the Tidehunter. Tidehunter, as soon as he hit 6, he's ready to TP down, he's ready to make some things happen. But, of course, that does leave room for Darkseer to kind of creep cut past the Tier 1 tower and get that early gold for his team as a whole. There's merits to both sides, but I do think that around the timing of level 6, Liquid has to play particularly cautious. As far as our laning phase goes, as far as CS goes, though, they're looking pretty good. We actually see some damage coming in. Mirana going to leap into the tree, tango her way out, but it might be too late. There's the double burrow onto Way 2. He's going to be taking some hits, but Fat Petzl will die first. Dropping the Soul Catcher on Shinx. They're looking to try to turn it back around, but it is just going to be that one for one.
Yeah, a first blood going the way of Liquid and a farming carry dropping on the side of Top5 makes that an extremely good trade for Liquid. And whatever was just a little too far away dealing with the creeps in the jungle, not really able to provide the extra damage that his team desperately needed.
Speed. That leap wasn't exactly on point either. Jumping to the east there was obviously not his full intention, and getting caught in the trees especially seems to be almost comical in how unfortunate that may be. But in the end, they still at least get a kill in exchange, but getting the first blood here, and who was actually the one to pick up the last hit? Morphling. So Quickova is going to be looking really strong coming in towards the next few minutes.
Yeah, this is... That's really not where you want the Morphling to be. Granted, the Morphling is not going to, like, all of a sudden be nasty at 9 minutes or whatever, no matter how much farming he has. It's just not going to happen, usually, at least. But looking at the late game for Liquid, their mid-game Kunkka doesn't exactly fall off. He's just not a great late-game character because he's all burst and no sustainability. But the Morphling is sustainability, and he'll come into late-game very strong. The Darkseer goes into late-game extremely strong. The Keeper Light has strong rat style in the late-game, although he himself is not a strong hero. And the Shadow Demon doesn't really fall off because Soul Catcher is a percent-based skill and not a hard-based skill like something, for example, Chilling Touch.
Yeah, so does have a little bit more tempo there, but honestly, once they get more points in the Chakra Magic, we can see Way 2 starting to skill up Shadow Poison extremely hard, and he just gets 3 or 4 stacks on there, and it's going to be that huge static damage you're looking for. One waveform, what the big Shadow Poison nuke, and somebody's gone, and Soul Catcher, of course, makes that threshold even easier to obtain. Now, I have a question for you. How do you think the Invoker factors into this try versus try? The aspect of Sunstrikes trying to be the equalizer, trying to put Top 5 ahead a little bit, do you think it's going to be enough to make up for the lost first blood?
Not in the laning phase. I mean, if you look at the Invoker, he is going Quas Wex, but he's got 3 Quas one Wex. He's going Quas Exort, is what I meant. But he is 3 on Quas and 1 on Exort. So he's not prioritizing the ability to really influence the other lanes with that Sunstrike. He's not prioritizing the ability to push, which is not entirely surprising because, once again, Top 5 doesn't really play push strats. They don't do it. They're looking for a strong team fight in the 15 to 20 minute range. That's where they want to win. They want to at least start to secure the victory and then be able to knock down towers off of that. But I don't know. They have a very small window of opportunity for great success in that. In the very early game, they're playing pretty passively, as you had predicted. In the very late game, they just don't have the potential for victory that the Kunkka is going to double damage up onto the high ground from Fly with that Tidebringer. But yeah, in the late game, they don't really have the damage output that Liquid has. So they've got, Petzl in the bottom lane.
Just some good harassment. I mean, he has the Chakra always at his back, so there's no reason not to go aggressive here. And the Illuminate is going to be able to steal up a lot of these Radiant creeps, as well as neutral. Shanks going to take a lot of damage. Waveform will come through, but he Burrow Strikes away, just barely dodging it. They will still try to pursue, but a very clutch Burrow Strike from Shanks.
Radiant's that arrow, Sacred Arrow, skipped over attack. The back end of that engagement as well, hoping to grab one of the supports so that they could turn around onto that Morphling, I think. But you know, he used the waveform twice. They know he doesn't have the mana. If they can stun out one of those supports, then it's a 3-on-1 or 3-on-2. With the Keeper of Light especially not being particularly useful in that sort of situation, they could have turned that around on the Morphling if that Sacred Arrow landed, but it just was a little bit off. Petzl not quite predicting that, but he was trying to shoot it blind, so.
Yeah, absolutely. They were just kind of running out. It's good to hope for, but obviously not fully reliable. Now, we will notice that Demon has gone for this build where he goes 2 for Illuminate and 1 for Chakra. This is mostly based on the fact of how many clarities they brought to the lane. We see Morphling still has a decent amount of regen coming from his, and that's just the 6.81 extension, where it does, over time, give him a little bit more mana there. And yeah, they're going to be pretty much ready to roll with their next set of punches. But one thing I want to highlight real quick before Action picks up yet again, is the aspect of the Sand King's jungle. He's going to be stacking up. We see a triple stack here in the central part of the jungle, and Liquid has a ton of stack steal potential. Waveform, Illuminate, even the Darkseer, if he rotated pretty far out of his own woods, would be able to iron shell it down. So with that in mind, Sand King has to take very significant care of his jungle, or Shanks is going to fall very far behind.
Yeah, this is... Oh, Demon going to whiff on that one, but it was a nice try, hoping that Patsol would get just a little bit out of his comfort zone. In the mid lane, we're going to have an action as the Torrent does land on Fly, and they're with the TP reaction coming out of the Sand King, they're just going to back out very smart. Just because the Soul Catcher's down doesn't mean that you can engage into a stun like Sand King.
Yeah, we are going to see some damage coming into Koikova, but it's really just poking and prodding, trying to harass him back a little bit here, and he can go for just one basic HP regen item, and he'll be perfectly fine. On top of that, he's got his Sav from the laning phase. He hasn't really taken that much harassment, so he's able to run this morph ratio of 19 to 44, strength to agility, and yeah, he's pretty much perfectly fine in any situation other than a Tidehunter. If Tidehunter rotates, then his life comes under threat, but Tide seems pretty content to just farm up on the top lane with this maxed Anchor Smash build.
Yep, and once again, it's just kind of going for the later selection. He's just buying time until that point dagger's up on the Sand King. The Mirana has her, presumably, Yasha up, or whatever it is that she's going to go for early, until the Invoker starts to get some more exhorts up. Like, he doesn't want to rotate. That's not how this team plays. They're just going to buy themselves some time to that 15-minute mark and then absolutely start decimating. But at least that's their goal. Now, the question is, will Liquid be able to counter on that with the strong Illuminates, with, oh, wow, and, yeah, lack of control. They're going to lose their entire stack to Demon.
And giving it to Koikova is going to be the worst thing possible. He's going to farm up each and every one of these neutral creeps, and this is going to hurt Sand King and help Liquid so, so much. This is why you run an aggressive tri-lane with this kind of a lineup, is because you control the Radiant Jungle, and Shanks, he's just got a big frowny face on him, because that is, he desperately needed to take advantage of that stack in order to get a blink dagger. Like, he'd almost be to a blink if he had that full stack, but...
He'd basically be there. I mean, between the time that it would have taken him to knock down with the do-do-do, and also with the gold that he would have gotten from said do-do-do, he would have been basically there. But now he's going to have to wait off. He probably won't get it till about 13 minutes at this rate. Maybe a little bit longer, but if he doesn't die, I'd say probably 13 minutes is when I would expect it.
It's pretty painful, because they're going to be receiving a lot of tower push from this point forward. The Aquila is up and active on Koikova. They've got the Illuminates rolling, and they're looking to dive, actually. There is some counter-initiation potential from Ancient Apparition, but minimal at best. They need the Tidehunter to rotate. Luckily, he does have that TP with his Arcane Boots coming off CD very shortly.
They're actually not going to rotate. They have the Moonlight Shadow up, so Petzl's not really in any real danger here as far as they know.
Oh, mid lane Fly going down with the last right click. Very nice combo. The 3 points in X into Torrent Boat, getting the kill with that DD rune.
That's all it takes, especially when the DD rune is available with that big splash. You don't even need to be anywhere near your opponent to absolutely wreck him. Sand King sitting here. He's going to maybe try to drag some creeps away, but I don't know that he really wants to be this close to TC. That X has proven itself very dangerous, and he still has a DD rune.
Radiant's
so.
Bottom tower is under attack.
In the bottom. Oh, go.
Gonna see some waveform out there, just controlling the creep wave extremely well to bring down the tier 1. It's still pretty difficult for the Kunkka to pick off the Sand King if he times his Sandstorm well, obviously. TC lacking any form of detection, but just getting control of the lane where he gets the free farm right now. He's sitting 52 for 11 CS, and obviously getting that kill for himself. He's feeling pretty good. If they get this tier 1 on top of that, Liquid can consider this a full-out victory in the early game.
So DJ is working on a mechanism. He's going to go not worry about the blink dagger right away. And that might be on the basis of the fact that the Sand King's not going to get his Blink Dagger up very quickly anyway. And remember, this is, once again, a squad that likes to go in together. They kind of handhold. They try to make sure that the draft lands so that all their heroes come into it at the same time. And try to make sure that the farming lands so that they all come into it at the same time. In fact, if you look at their net worth, they're all right next to each other. They're barely even prioritizing farm on one hero to another.
Yeah. Moonlight Shadow try to help Fly get out of dodge. It looks like he'll just drop off the ice wall and be able to walk away. But that's the first big cooldown that they'll commit here. That's, I think, their first ulti, other than, of course, Invoke. So they're going to be trying to time their attacks very carefully. But with some good warding from Liquid, they can feel safe and sound for another 2 minutes.
All right, so still no towers down for Top 5, which is good news for them, all things considered. They have not really had that great of control through this early game, but they haven't lost that much other than the fact that they haven't really managed to control their own jungle. They haven't managed to control their lanes. In terms of sustainable control throughout the late game, the towers and the, you know, making sure that the farm that they have stays in their pocket by not dying. That is going more or less all right, though they are about 4,000 gold in deficit right now. Not really where you want to be at 12 minutes, but not the end of the world either. There is going to be the TP down by the Tidehunter finally. So we are going to see some, probably our first big team fight coming up here soon if Liquid wants to engage on it.
Yeah. For right now, as far as Bulba's position, he is sitting at level 11, has 1 point in his Wall of Replica, probably getting the second in just one more level. Mechanism up, and is sitting in a pretty good position where if he wanted to, with that Soul Ring coming off cooldown, he could rotate as well. For now, though, I think he's just going to put out pressure on the tier 1, get that massive amount of farm. If he gets a blink at a good time, Liquid has Radiant's a ton of potential. You throw out a boat, and you blink vacuum them right on top of it with a wall, maybe a waveform illuminate, that's just 100-0, the entire enemy team dropping down.
The AoE coming out of Liquid is staggering. It's a lot of burst too, but it's burst that doesn't fall off in the late game, and that's the important aspect of it to keep in mind. The waveform, that falls off sort of in its damage, but the fact that it's bringing in a huge DPS hero does not fall off. The Shadow Poison doesn't really fall off that much because it does stack. The Kunkka is going to make the Tidebringer continue to stack up, and the fact that the Rum has that percent-based Rum Radiant's bonus as well for the big AoE coming out of the ship, that falls off a little, but not as much. Mm-hmm. A lot of Liquid's damage stays with them in the late game, which is atypical for teams that have big AoE.
Yeah, and the Blink Dagger is already up for Bulba with that tier 1 tower kill. There it is. That's exactly what they're looking for to start firing on all cylinders. Pretty much they have the potential to take any fight at this point in the game, and it's going to be very difficult for Top5 to hold it. They do have the Epicenter available for the level 6 Sand King, but he's only running 2 points in Burrow Strike and 1 in Boots of Speed, so that means that he isn't going to be able to reliably get that Epi off unless the stars align, essentially. DJ going to go hard onto Way 2 here, but 3 stacks of Shadow Poison. We're going to see Morphling go for the waveform here, but no Ravage to turn things around a little bit. Way 2 has the disruption in 5, but there's the blink, there's the mech, there's the wall coming out, and DJ dropping low. Now they will pull him back with the X under the Sentry Ward, and DJ should fall as well. A great movement from Liquid, 4 versus 2. They force out the Ravage, and they still take it 2 for 0. A great movement from Bulba.
They're going to grab that tower as well. Absolutely free. And that whole time, right up until Darkseer came down, Bulba was farming out a huge stack in the jungle as well up top. At least a double stack with the poles out of that top lane. So not only that, he's managed to get up his Blink Dagger and his Mechanism in the amount of time that it has taken the Tidehunter to get up on Mechanism. And the Sand King still doesn't have a Blink Dagger.
Yeah, this is just an awkward position for them to be in. The Sand King is immobile. Like, he might have Epicenter, but honestly, I'd almost prefer to have a third point in Burrow Strike. Like, he's just so unable to pursue his targets and get those ultis off reliably. Along with that, the Ancient Apparition is not even level 6 yet. No ulti available. This is really Liquid's time to shine, and they are certainly putting the pressure on here. We see their movement across the map here. We have Kunkka building up that Shadow Blade, making his way back to the mid lane, and otherwise, Quickova's happy to just farm up on the safe lane and finish up that Linkit Sphere at record time.
Yeah, 7,500 gold lead in the way of Liquid. They don't really have any burden to be active here. They've got plenty of time to get up the Keeper Lights of Ganims. They've got plenty of time to get up some basic damage items and Linkit Sphere up on the Morphling. He's got to get that Ghost Scepter up, that maybe Ethereal Blade if he can get it all the way up. And of course, finish off that Linkit, which is getting very, very close to finish. Meanwhile, Top 5 are in a position that they really don't like to be in. They have to get active now and before they're ready. In the mid lane, we are going to see the Cold Snap going out onto TC. TC is going to dodge that Sunstrike. Very nice call. He's going to pop a salve and then maybe reinitiate here. He's turning back around. He's getting ready. He's got the boat. He's full health. Popped a regen rune as well as the salve, actually. Is under attack.
Yeah, the passive play will still speed them away to victory. I mean, right now, Quickova gets free time to push out on the top lane. Whatever can't really do that much to him. So even if they don't get the full initiation here, they're happy just to waste some time for Top 5, continue to press their advantage, and move into their next stage. When they group together, that's when the sparks really fly. But as far as TP scrolls go, Bulba and Demon both are carrying theirs, so they can rotate when the pressure is on. They pretty much will wait and play responsibly, reactively, and that's where they make the most impact. But it has given a little bit more time for Top 5 to get all their ducks in a row. Now we'll see Way 2 getting picked off here. Bad position for him, but the boat will fly onto the Invoker. Fortunately, he's in safe territory with that mechanism available. So just a misposition from the Shadow Demon.
What was Way2 doing up there? He didn't have wards. He wasn't trying to place anything. Was he just coming around for a flank, maybe expecting a teamfight to start soon?
Yeah, I honestly find it kind of unfathomable, but, you know, making the risky plays, trying to start something off. In the end, it's not the most impactful of kills, though it does technically double up Top5's kill gold.
Yeah, it's a nice Radiant's little top tower parting is under gift, attack. But it's not going to turn Radiant's the game in any significant way. It does mean this little mid-game section of... the torrent's out, but it will miss. Illuminate not going to land either. Yeah, it does mean that this little fronting potential team fight that is coming out here in the mid lane, Jinx is going to have to burst strike away, and now the X is up onto DJ. DJ is going to be pulled back into the boat. It is going to land, and the Torrent's there as well. The damage is out there. Ravage goes out, but there's not going to be any reinitiation potential coming out of this.
Wow.
Vacuum Wall is going to be on there. Has whatever and fly. Very ill. Yeah, bad decision to go back in there. They are now both on the run. The Murana trying to cover up their retreat, but she is going to get a nice arrow at the follow-up stun, and wow, nice turnaround coming out of the top by Patzel, making sure that they go even there. And somehow, Shanks gets away.
Yeah, that is actually quite surprising. One big thing there is that Quickfoot didn't feel necessary to rotate. He had the TP scroll, but wanted to finish off that tower. He commits to it. He gets the tower kill. But I kind of feel like they could have cleaned that up just so much more succinctly if the Morphling had rotated. Either way, the Darkseer gets creamed. He doesn't get a chance to use the mechanism, just his Soul Ring, which obviously reduces his effective HP. And then Kunkka eats a number of stuns to get dropped down as well. So in the end, a 2-for-2, but with the big cooldown there, the Ravage being expended. Sure, the Darkseer wall was as well, but it's not as big of a cooldown, and they just straight up don't need it that much to actually win these fights. Still a win for top five as far as the kills go, but with that tier 2 tower dropping down, more momentum for Team Liquid.
Yeah, so that either way, whether or not the Morphling rotated, that would have been a great trade for Liquid. This way they get a tower, the Morphling is free farming, and they still wouldn't even in trades. If the Morphling rotated, they probably would have gotten four heroes, at the very least three. I think they with the waveform, they would have been able to get the AA and also get the Sand King out of that. So either way, and they probably would have gotten the mid tower. So yeah, the rotation possibly would have been the better call, because they still would have gotten the tower and maybe two additional heroes, but... At the same time, it's not like it was a bad trade.
Sure.
It was a great trade for them. The Morphling's now at 8,700 net worth compared to less than 6,000. Wow, why can't I think of the word thousand? Man, I am fragged today. Less than 6,000 on the Invoker. So he's Quickva is doing very, very well, making sure that he's getting his farm everywhere. His Lincoln's is up. He's going to have the Ghost Scepter up soon. He's actually taking the stacks that were probably intended for the Darkseer or the Keeper of Light, but it's not like they're going to say anything about it. So these are mine now, Quickva says. you can go into the opponent's jungle, take their stacks all you want. This jungle is my jungle.
Exactly. I mean, you look at the warding vision right now, Liquid have really set their feet in. They're saying, we're going to take control of your territory. First, the Radiant Ancients as well, the Radiant top lane, securing Quickva that split push. It's just a good general map control. They're going to have to refresh some wards here. We see some dropping down in the central part of the Radiant jungle, but it's just really the emphasis is on taking the enemy's territory, making sure that they give them no quarter. So
they're just starving them out, and that's a great way to handle top five, because once again, starve them out, they can't do anything at all, and now they're going to rotate down onto the Invoker, who's way too far forward. There's really no excuse for him to be out this far. He's going to throw the Cold Snap, and the Shadow Demon actually falling a little bit behind, but there's the Vacuum, the Shadow Poison going out, and actually the A-Ult's going to come in here. Nice response coming out of Demon and TC. They're trying to come in here and get that. The Moonlight Shadow's up, but the Vision is there. There's going to be the Disruption, followed by the Soul Catcher. The Luminate goes out, but it misses. Not needed, just covering up as a backup coming out of that attack. Demon.
In the meantime, there is going to be Ravage coming off cooldown in the mid. Fortification will pop, but Quickva looking for initiation. They just need the X mark. It's a very long-range spell, 950, but they actually aren't going to pursue too far here. Just clearing out the creep wave, keeping their towers alive. As long as they have the tower advantage, they seem to be pretty happy here. One thing I do want to highlight on is, as far as GPM goes, we are seeing not only Morphling doing extremely well, but also Bulba. He was able to take the top tier 1, has farmed up 140 CS, and he's going to be moving towards his next item at an extremely fast pace. Like, he's 20 minutes in, Blink, Mech, and 3200 in the bank. He could have a Shiva's, he can have an Aghanim's, whatever he really wants. Heck, a Hex would be extremely good too.
Yeah, a Hex would be great, a Shiva's would be great, an Assault Cuirass would be really great too. They could do basically, even... with this squad, because of all the magical damage that is coming out of them, I wouldn't even hate him grabbing a veil early on just to amplify that vacuum wall into the illuminate with the waveform. That is a lot of magic damage that is already risking blowing up the other team. Throw a veil on that, and you are looking at devastating team fight, giving top five absolutely no recourse. So they have a lot of good options.
Yeah, I like the way you think, man. That veil would be so much fun to see if the Morphling was rushing out the Ethereal Blade especially, but it looks like Corkova is going to go a little bit more of a passive build. He's going to look for a BKB, and that will deal with a lot of their threats. It's kind of a no-brainer to get it eventually against the Tidehunter, even on a hero that naturally doesn't pick it up. So it is going to be helping them out, and really, if you think about it, once Morphling pops that 10-second BKB, what is top 5 able to do to Qualifiers? Like, they can melt his armor with the Forge Spirits, they can deliver a few pinpricky right clicks, but Mirana, she's gone for Perseverance and Midas. She just doesn't have the right click damage that she needs to deal with that threat.
She's trying to get up a Lincoln's, but she's not going to be anywhere near as farmed as this Morphling at any stage in the game. Even with the Midas, which honestly, I'm not sure exactly when it came out, but the first time I saw it was pretty late. So I expect that came out fairly late, like 8-9 minutes, something like that is my expectation. I'd have to check the replay to be sure. But Mirana has a really good late game win rate, but she has a really good late game win rate with early game aggression and with a second core. Their Invoker as a second core is sitting at 0-3, still on Brown Boots, and is not going to be coming in as an effective second core anytime, especially with Morphling just kind of sauntering up and just passively backhanding his own tower down. Nice deny, and there's nothing that Invoker could have done about that.
Down bottom lane, Patzel needs to time this lead very carefully. Not going to happen. He gets it up by the Torrent, and there is going to be no recourse for TC. He just walks away, gets plenty of mana right back up, and they can ensue on the push, but Qualifiers, under some pressure with the Ice Blast, looks like that's not going to connect, and he's just going to be able to go back into his jungle with minimal concern for his own safety. Like, they have two heroes up here, but what can really Shanks and Fly do? They have to do the perfect epicenter combo, maybe get a mana burn off with the Necro, but that's already on cooldown. They're still going to try for it, but I really don't know if this is going to happen. Like, he's going to take the hits. He's a lot of damage from this epicenter, but a quick waveform out. Yep. Lincoln's fear OP.
And that's a quick waveform out. They don't even know. He might even have a replicant somewhere. I don't know that it was really a good call to even move on Quakerbud there. They obviously have to kill him. They have to try. But that was not the time or the place. They don't know if he has a replicant somewhere, so even if they'd had a really good initiation, he could have just disappeared at any moment. There's no way for them to know. And I don't know. It just seemed kind of high in the sky to use the epicenter on that in the mid lane.
Popping off the disruption, gonna get the demonic purge under sentry, easy kill, and it's also a little bit of salt and wound. Way too got the last hit on the tower, is gonna get denied, but now the ravage comes through, boat onto a couple, but TC's gonna take a lot of damage here. Rum will keep up for the moment. Here comes the mech. Bulba, low on mana, won't be able to counter initiate. It's gonna be on Qualifiers, but here's a great stun from Shanks. Finally getting some kills on the board, but Qualifiers answers back in turn, bringing down the Sand King. Bulba on the run, blink dagger off cooldown. He disjoints the auto attack at the last second. Patzel with four stacks of that Shadow Poison. Gonna take a big hit here, and Qualifiers looking to bring him down. No, Patzel walks away. And Qualifiers looks to just head back to his base, not wanting to go in 1v3. But even still, a really good fight for top 5, getting the damage they needed to bring down at least the Kunkka. Unfortunately, not able to get anything more, as Bulba just narrowly avoids the Ice Blast, as well as, obviously, that Mirana's auto attack.
Yeah, Bulba was really playing the margins there, doing very well. He ended up going for a BKB. Mm-hmm. So didn't really go for the team fight item that we expected him to go. All the things that we listed off were kind of like, oh, he could help his team. And he already has the mech. He thinks it's time to get something nice for himself. Every now and then you got to treat yourself, right? So he gets the BKB, keep himself up that much longer, be that much more of a nuisance in these fights. And Liquid has all the time in the world to get their team fight items up. I mean, they're already rocking and they don't even have up the items that are really going to make them scary, like the crit stick on the Kunkka. You know, they don't have the Aghanims up on their Keeper of the Light yet. They don't have a Shiva's up on the Darkseer. They don't have a Sheeper up anywhere. They don't have the Ghost Scepter up even on the Morphling. Like, they're doing very well considering a lot of what might be considered core items haven't even hit them yet.
Yeah, we're going to see a gank attempt down on bottom. TC pops the boat off to try to bring down the Invoker, but a very quick reaction with the Ghost Walk. He did have a couple of times to think about what he was going to do because of the X mark, but no matter what, it's very important that he survives at this stage. Now, some good counter push coming in for Keep the Light. It's just so hard to bring down these tier 1s. They man-moded the tier 1 in the mid lane, and obviously got some good kills out of the fight that ensued. But that's the one of two towers that they've taken 25 minutes into the game with a lineup that can push relatively well with the Invokers, Forge Spirits, etc. We do see the Moonlight Shadow coming out, but obviously scouted out by Liquid, they're just going to fall back.
Can I just mention real quick how strong of a game Way Too Sexy's been playing right now? Not only is he positive as a support, but he's been doing pretty much a hard six slot for the most part, letting that Keeper of the Light get up his items. He's been buying all the wards, he's been buying smoke, he's been buying sentries, he's kept the entire map counter warded, and he's only died once doing so, where he did go down in that mid lane. He was counter warding off on that peninsula area. Mm-hmm. He's been doing a great job just making sure that his team has complete map control. Really great support play, and it has been helping tremendously.
Yeah, making a very huge impact. I mean, it's really hard to last at a tower with 76 damage, but outclassing the Ancient Apparition by a clean 9 auto attack damage, he was able to get their last hit on their tower as well. So, I mean, like, they're just securing those opportunities and then following up with kills by constantly carrying sentry wards in case of Moonlight Shadow and setting his team up for success. I do think that this is definitely one of those players that you got to say needs to get some appreciation for what he's been accomplishing this game.
Yeah, it's just really, really easy to ignore the fact that he's a support. He's a hard 5 support doing the role of both supports. But look at this. Both Walther and Roshan, he just kind of backs out and he counter wards everything immediately. He gets up here, he counter wards this entire area, and then he drops a ward here, checks high ground, and also throws out the shadow poison. In one fell swoop, he checked every single warning area possible.
Yeah.
And it was just absolutely automated. Very nice play coming out of Way 2.
Mm-hmm. And the vision that they get from this observer ward on the western side of the jungle will allow them to dodge out the ice blast, and at nearly full HP, they take this Roshan 27 minutes into the game. Aegis up on Quekova, he's got his 10 second BKB and Ghost Scepter. What can you do to this guy to actually bring him down now? Like, he has so much going for him. You get the boat over top of him, a mech behind him, and he pops the BKB. He's literally unkillable even at full agility.
Yeah, and that is not even including the Ganym's Illuminates that are going to be healing him up the whole time. And the fact that if he does get in trouble, he can start switching on to the strength. Like, I don't know. It would take all of top 5 to probably kill that Morphling. With Radiant's the Morphling being completely alone and silenced.
Yeah. Like, Radiant's they really need no the Ice Blast to be, like, perfect. They always have to hit the Morphling with it, or he won't be able to be brought down by anything less than the fountain itself.
Yeah, and they need to get a way to silence him out, because the waveform is going to be enough to get him away even if he's caught an ice blast, and the replicate is going to be enough to get him away even if he's caught an ice blast almost every time. So they need to, not only do they need to hit him with the ice blast, they need to be able to hold him in place either with the silence or a really long stun. Sacred Arrow is going to miss, but at least it did scout out a little bit. They see what's going on. And I don't know. 12,000 gold has been the story of the day for about 7 minutes, but 12,000 gold, just because you've evened that out, does not make that less painful for top 5. It's still a lot of gold to be missing at less than 30 minutes.
Yeah, in this position, I gotta say that Liquid just have so much more scalability. I mean, late game, you can actually get Way 2 to disrupt Quakova, and you can actually use the Replicant on his own illusion, so he can get a little buddy there that has insane values in agility, and that's a really, really powerful thing to do. And of course, later on, he just scales so hard. Morphling, one of the harder carries in the game, especially when he gets going like this.
Yeah, there's just not a lot you could do. I mean, if the Invoker and the Murana were both farming equivalently to the Morphling, then maybe, you know, the fact that he's super hard would be offset by the fact that top 5 has a dual core, right? The Invoker is not a slouch himself. With full Exhort, he pumps out a ton of damage. But I don't know. The Kunkka is farming out better than either of those two. The Morphling is farming out way better than either of those two. So, dual core coming out of top 5, but both the cores are rotten. It's just not going to support them throughout this late game. And Shanks is possibly going to go down here.
Yeah,
he's
going to
be waveformed over.
Yeah, he's just going to back off here, but it sucks when your best bet is just to go out to the lane, try to sandstorm, and sit around 300 HP against the enemy carry. You're not ganking him, you're just surviving against him. That's pretty sad to say.
And this is one of the reasons why top 5's games last so long. When they fall behind, they play very passively. They are not a risk-taking team. Mm-hmm. They will, even if it's by death by atrophy, they will hold still and wait for the perfect pitch, even if it's never going to come. And we see them waiting. They've lost barely any gold over the last 10 minutes, but they're so far behind that it doesn't really matter that they're not losing anything. Unlike a lot of teams that would, by 30 minutes, have said, all right, you know what? We have to make an opportunity happen. Top5 says, we're going to wait for an opportunity to happen to us, which is why they don't lose less than 30 minutes very often, because they're so patient. Even their losses last a long time.
So they'll try to hold the line here, but it's going to be difficult. Ethereal Blade comes out for the Morphling. They've got a lot of BKBs up. I think three BKBs now, which for the most part renders the enemy lineup irrelevant. Now we see the defensive disruption trying to keep Koikova or Weitu alive, but he's going to get hit up by that Ice Blast and Sunstrike. Now we see the big nukes coming out on Patzel, but with the Lincolns, he'll be able to at least shrug it off.
Yeah, and they can't get out. They've got no vision. They have one outer tier tower left. I mean, they're going to, okay, Moonlight Shadow, they're going to go and see if they can find something, but expect them to fall back if they have any inclination that this is not going to work out. Like, once again, they don't like to take big risks. They're going to find Demon, and this is going to be it right here.
Very nice. Burrow Strike into Arrow Gem, hits the deck, and TC is the only one really standing here. Quick of a big shotgun coming out under the Ancient Apparition, but Shanks is waiting in the wings. Epicenter available, but no. They are actually going to force him to go and retreat. Sandstorm away. Fly pops the BKB, doing the damage he can to Quick of a, and Mana Burns him down, but here's Boba with the back, with the wall, and with the turret. Huge damage coming out from Liquid. The Ravage, however, answering in turn, popping the Aegis, but that's a full HP and Mana Morphling. Shanks coming in, not really doing much with this Epicenter here, and now going to get burned down with all these nukes. Finally, the cleave coming out from TC snipes him while in viz, and that is going to be a 4-for-1, getting the gem back and just putting on a clinic here.
Yeah, that was... Oh, poor Shanks went in. He thought he had Quakeba's number. He's like, as soon as that Aegis comes off, I'm going to rock in with that Epicenter and just be the playmaker of the day, and it did. He just mistimed it by like 2.5 seconds. Really rough. They wasted 4 or 5 of those Epicenter bursts. It just really, really, they landed only like 3 of them. And
oh, Koikova. He's got that shotgun and he had his replicate ready to go. This is diving tier 4s to get free kills.
I was really, really surprised when Koikova in that jungle started to back out. And I realized now he was just waiting for the Darkseer to come and waiting for Bulba to come in and help. But honestly, Koikova with that Aegis was in a position where he might have been able to safely go 1-on-5. Mm-hmm. He's going to get hit by that big sacred arrow, though.
That's going to hurt, but nice defensive disruption. That's going to bring Koikova right back into it. Pops the 10-second BKB, going ham onto DJ, onto Fly. He's to decide his target. He's going to burst down on the Tidehunter. That gem is on the ground. Now we do see Shanks hitting on TC, but the gem's already in his hands, and they dodge out the arrow. Bulba is going to eat it, but he's got plenty of HP to spare. The Ice Blast going onto 2, no, dodged out by Koikova. He goes hard onto Patzel here. Adapt to strike, not going to be enough to finish the job, but enough to ward them off as they try to finish off these racks here. They do have the mech coming back. Actually, it's off cooldown now. They're just going ahead and earning up before they go in retreat.
And they are just going to back out. Got the racks. That's all they need. Top5 is happy to keep playing. Like, they'll run this until they are mega'd, and they will keep going usually. Like, they do not care. They're just waiting for their opponents to make mistakes, which, out of Liquid, they make some mistakes on the pro stage, but right now they are playing absolutely together and really synced up. I would not expect a playmaking or a game-making throw to come out of Liquid right now. They are really synced. And in the top lane.
Oh, wow. There's actually going to be damage coming out onto Invoker. Overstepped his bounds by far, and they're going to punish him hard. Quakeva, just after buying up two ulti orbs from the side shop, replicates right back in to finish off the racks, and this is going to be one of the earlier GGs to come out from top 5, to be certain. Like, they can just push in on all lanes right now, and that should be the nail hammered into the coffin.
Yep. Because why not get a Lincoln's plus 2 ultimate orbs, Radiant's right? Middle tower is under attack. It's obvious that Quirkama realizes, like, this isn't going to go late enough for me to need any other items. Let me just stat up as much as I possibly can before I go in and bulldoze their base.
Scotty Dodo. It's one of the best items in the game for Morphling, and he's got everything else to really make it so that he can just go full agi. Right now, 1 to 137 on that ratio, and he can just adapt to strike so freaking hard.
Yeah, he is throwing out very, very strong attacks, and TC's no slouch either. He's sending out, 240 basically with every attack, with the Tidebringer going in with an additional 60. So Tidebringer's of 300 damage going out, physical damage across the team. That's hard enough to deal with when you don't have a more.
Oh, jeez.
Later.
Exactly. AA can't stand that. Hell, half the heroes seem to be easily dropped down by that combo if he commits the waveform as well. So, yeah, Koikova just controlling the map perfectly with his amazing net worth values, and there's absolutely nothing they can do. I mean, he's only spent one charge of his BKB, and that was to dominate a fight towards the top rack. So, honestly, in this position, TC going out for the... they're actually changing targets to Shanks here. He's going for the epicenter onto Demon, but again, the Epi just doesn't do enough. Now, bursted down by great nukes coming from the Morphling. The wall will be committed on Pat's soul alone, but they're just willing to charge in at this point and claim the enemy base as their own.
They have massive survivability. Epicenter falls off so hard. Unlike Vacuum Wall, Epicenter's magic damage doesn't really last through the late game. And... I don't think there's another team in this tournament or in any of the qualifiers in any region of the world that would have not called GG by now, except Top 5. They're the only ones that would play out through this. 1 to 142 Morphling, who's now got himself a full Scotty. So he is actually going to finish that off. I didn't think that he'd have time, but he did have
top
time.
Top 5 will give them time, that's for sure.
Yeah. So 36 minutes, it feels like 50 or 60, though. Because there's just been a lot of being dominated. The shotgun is almost enough to hit top 5 Fly. Fly gets the BKB off after the he gets smacked by that, so just a waste of a charge as well.
Yeah, well, if he waveformed, that'd be a dead invoker too, so it's kind of necessary, but obviously Koikova not going that ham, only just now putting up the Replicant. But they're going to push in this final bottom lane, and that will be plenty. The final last stand of top 5, they've got the Ice Blast, they've got the Ravage, let's see what they can do, but honestly, if Koikova pops BKB, the fight's already over.
The Lincoln's going to be popped there, he's going to get slowed, the negative armor there. He's sitting on only 30 armor.
Now go again, great double burrow after the Ravage, huge damage from the Invoker, but just answering back, Liquid, take it away. They force the death of the Shadow Demon, the buyback of the Invoker, but damn, does Koikova hit hard. Finally, they tap out. GG, coming
for
top 5.
It's just not possible for top 5.
If they had the Epicenter, honestly, like, they could have killed more, but still, Koikova could 1v5, like you said. They were just so frickin' farmed and carrying the team to victory. Liquid played outstanding this game.
All right, well, yeah. Very well played by Liquid. Top 5 maybe having a little bit of trouble with their standings, but they, I think, are still in the top 4 with this loss. Not 100% sure. They're definitely in the top 5. They've been doing pretty well. We'll take a look at the standings, and there are some additional streams going on for later today, but that is it for Join Dota Community. So thanks for having me out, Blaze.
Yeah, and of course, happy to be able to cover the at least one game here in the North American qualifiers. For those that aren't sure of the schedule, which is probably anybody, I'm going to be covering a lot of the Southeastern Asian qualifiers as well as Chinese qualifiers on Join Dota Community, and I may be co-casting for Europe as well. So we're gonna have a lot of switch up of casters. Obviously, you've seen some great commentary from Dragon Drop as well as Gorgon earlier today, and yeah, I'm gonna be happy to be able to take the reins, but for day one and day twos only. The 3 and 4 is gonna be specifically for like the EU hub and the bigger streams there. We're just covering up where the overlap may lie.
Yeah, I'll be doing a lot of the Asia as well, and we might have actually overlap with each other once again, but I'll be over there, and I'll also be on the EU a little bit, so you guys will see me around. And if you want to follow me and know when I'm casting, go on over to Twitter, support me by following me at GotCowDota, and of course, follow Blaze at BlazeCasting.
Indeed. Well, this was an awesome game to cast to, I believe, conclude our broadcast for today, but yeah, Liquid hammering it home, and they will be securing a top 2 spot for this NA qualifier here in the International 4 Regional. So that's going to be it for us. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. Hopefully you guys enjoyed, and we will see you guys on the next one.